Okay, we'll see if that's true. Hey, if you're wondering, no, we do not have new church uniforms. These are our camp shirts because late last night we got back from camp, and we all survived, right? And I mean that literally. We all survived. We all came back okay. So to start this morning, before I know, like we're still a little bit tired, I have my hype crew over here. They're gonna get us woken up, okay? They're gonna help us this morning, okay? Now here's the thing. I saw you guys at camp, so if that doesn't happen here, it's gonna hurt my heart just a teensy bit. But before that, I do wanna share our experience. We had an amazing week at camp, and so if you guys would, please check out, we'll bring the lights down, please check out this video.
We're gonna have it.
That was our week. If you're jealous and you're over 12th grade, I'm sorry. Maybe volunteer to be a youth leader. That'd be awesome. If you would like to experience that and you are a student, come and join us. We'd love to have you. And just to share some exciting news, we did have, as you saw, there's a Jeunesse Park tradition that with new salvations, they ring a bell on the last day before we go out. And so we actually had two brand new salvations, dedications to Christ, which is just the reason that we go. And the even bigger number, and this could mean that you want to start serving God more, you want to start getting closer to God, you kind of want to turn your life around. You followed Christ, you've already dedicated your life to Christ, but it's time to turn things around. If you rededicated your life to Christ, stand up if that was you that rededicated your life to Christ for the first time. Yeah. Amazing. 20 people stood up to rededicate their life to Christ. And I actually had a lot of really awesome conversations with what that meant, whether that was plugging into a new group after they graduated or serving the church more or feeling a call to ministry. We have two people that said that they feel a vocational call to full-time ministry as well, which is incredible. When our church is producing disciple makers, that's amazing. That's an awesome thing. So an amazing week at camp with so many stories. If you follow us on Instagram, you've seen the chaos and fun that we've had. But that fun was all to glorify God and make his name known. And so we're going to do that together. Okay, so this first song we did at camp. So I need you guys, just like camp, I need you guys to come on up here, okay? Like I said, this is my hype crew. So here's the thing, let's all stand. If you're at home listening, you can stand up, I guess. Let's all stand, all right? We're gonna embrace our inner seventh grader, okay? Can we do that? I think we can. So whatever they do, I want you guys to do. Can we do that? Can I trust you with that? Okay, we have a huge worship team this morning. Are we ready? Because you might have to like bend down a little bit, okay? Oh yeah, why? Come on, bring it on. Here we go. Join them, come on, loosen up a little bit. I see people standing still, that's not allowed. Here we go. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could care? Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing but not. Let's start moving. Come on. Alive. Go. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb. It was my tomb. Yeah. Till I met you. There we go. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Oh, come on, join him. Let's go. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name. We're gonna sing Now Your Mercy. Here we go. Now Your Mercy has saved my soul. Now Your freedom. Now Your freedom is all that I know. The old made new in His image. The old made new. Jesus, when I met You. Show them what to do. We gotta get low. Here we go. Ready? Here we go. Keep going. Keep that clap going. Come on. Join us, everybody. Embrace that. Yo. I love that some of you are just sitting. That's great. Here we go. Ready?
I need a rescue. My son is hurting. The chains break up and they hold me. I need a shelter. I wasn't working. Now you call me a city.
Stars arise. Here we go.
When I was broken, one, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. Cause when you call my name, shout it.
My name is Jeannie Greenman, and I work with the Skate Riot Ministry as well as host the 1015 online service. These are your announcements for July 16th, 2023. Skate Riot is having a hangout at Lime Street Park on July 22nd at 11 a.m. Come down and hang out with us. There will be snacks, drinks, and giveaways. You'll be surprised at how many kids show up to talk to us about Jesus. We'd love to have you come out with us. And if you can't come out, you can drop off water bottles or snacks at the church office this week. Join us for a Koinonia summer picnic on Saturday, July 29th from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. There will be outdoor activities for the whole family. The lunch main dish is provided, but we ask that you bring a side or dessert to share. The event will finish with a time of worship in the sanctuary. Please be here for this fun time together. The next real meeting is Saturday, August 5th at 10 a.m. This meeting is for ministry leaders, workers, and those that are interested in getting more involved with our church. There's a men's breakfast on Saturday, August 12th at 8:30 a.m. This breakfast is a time for the guys to get together and hang out while they're eating good food. The suggested donation is $3. Invite a friend and come out and have some time with the guys. Ladies, sign up for the women's conference taking place this fall. It's a getaway for the weekend to be poured into spiritually and enjoy a great time of fellowship and fun. The deadline to sign up with a $100 deposit is Sunday, August 6th. For more information, visit the Welcome Center. On the chair in front of you, you'll find three QR codes. The first one is the Welcome Code. That's for those of you that are with us for the first time or have finally decided to let us get to know you a little bit better. The second code is the Serve Code. You can scan that and one of our ministry leaders will get in contact with you about how you can be more involved with one of the ministries here at our church. If you want to give financially to Living Hope, you can scan the Give Code. You can also put your tithes and offerings in the black boxes at the back of the sanctuary as you're leaving. Or you can visit our new church website. We are really excited that you're here with us today and we hope that you enjoy the service. Have a great week.
Good morning.
Morning.
How much time do I got? No, it's okay. You have a Bible, turn to the book of Matthew chapter 5. Busy week around here, as you can see. There's students up in Jeunesse. We had some students out at Ironwood as well. So it was kind of camp week around here. And so they all come back and ready to go. It's funny to see them all fanning here. It's hilarious to me, right? I'm doing like that. So it was great. Glad you guys had a great, great time up there. I'm going to start in verse 1. Matthew chapter 5. When he saw the crowds, he went up on the mountain. And after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the humble, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs." Let's pray. Father, thank you for a wonderful time of worship and celebration this morning. We're grateful that by your grace and your providence, our students had a great week at camp. Lord, we continue to lift them up to you and pray for what the decisions they made up there, that you would continue to speak to them and speak to all of us. And Lord, as I pray every week, I pray I would decrease and you increase. Speak to our hearts and to our minds, not just for information, but for transformation. Make us more like Jesus for your glory and your kingdom. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. You know, it's naive to think that conflict, war, and battle have not been a constant part of our world that we live in. You can go all the way back in Genesis. You can go all through the Bible. You can go all through the history of humanity. War and conflict and battle are constant. Even in our world now, there's battle in Africa. Most of us know about what's going on in Ukraine if you watch any amount of news as well. You know, people often say they don't want to fight. And they say that people should not have to fight. We seem to have this naive belief in our world today that somehow in our own human nature that we'll get to a place where humanity will see no need to fight anymore. It's just not proven to be true. And the world certainly doesn't seem to be progressing in such a way that it's going to happen anytime soon. And the reason for that is real simple. It's because in and of ourselves, we can't do it. No government, no leader, nobody can cause us to say, we don't need to fight anymore. I heard somebody say once, this is an old expression, and said something along the lines, what if they called for a war and nobody showed up? That never seems to happen, though. Power is a powerful thing. Sin is more powerful than that. Jesus talks about this when he talks about in Matthew 24, the times near the end and all those things. He says, you are going to hear of wars and rumors of wars, and we do. He says, see to it that you're not alarmed, because these things must take place, but the end is not yet. Jesus realizes, he's God, that war is an inevitable part of our fallen condition as humanity. In the midst of this reality, in the midst of all that's going on in the Roman world at the time, and as Jesus sits down and he shares with the disciples and they're standing around him, he calls the disciples to be peacemakers. He calls them to be peacemakers. He calls us to be peacemakers. Now, he probably had in mind those who were called zealots at the time when he thought about this. Zealots were those who really didn't like Rome at all. They hated Rome with a passion, and they didn't feel like negotiation or any type of like that was worthy of it. They just said, we got to just blow this thing up. And they were zealous for that. We would call them today terrorists. That's what we would call them in their mind of that. There was a zealot that was a part of Jesus' 12. But in the kingdom culture, God approves and the people are blessed who pursue peace. Thank you, two people. And Jesus says, these are the sons and daughters of God. It obviously begs the question, what is a peacemaker? The word there is an interesting compound word. It's the idea of shalom. A person who restores peace to people. It's a person who works for peace. It's not necessarily the cessation of war, but rather a reconciliation amongst people. We're supposed to be peacemakers. And that doesn't just have to be between countries and nations as they do what they do, but people amongst our own family, our own community, our own world around us. The shalom that he talks about was a common phrase. When you hear somebody say shalom, they're saying peace. It's hello, but it's even more than that. It's more than just saying having peace in your life. It's an idea of wholeness and well-being, that your life is well-rounded and that you have peace spiritually, emotionally, socially. It's not the absence of trouble either. But in the midst of all of those things, you still work for peace, a complete wholeness of life. That's what Jesus is talking about. This kind of person is not passive, but active. Too many people think peacemaker means you don't do anything. If you're a peacemaker, maker implies you do something. We're not supposed to be peacekeepers. We are called to be peacemakers. That means we are to do our part and be active in that. It's those kinds of things. A peacemaker is then one who is actively pursuing peace in all its fullness. Peace amongst others, peace in our community, peace with God. Peace in life. Isn't that what people seem to want most? Boy, people talk about, I don't have any peace about this. I love this phrase. I don't have any peace about this situation. Well, what does that mean? It means that the decision you have to make or the decision you made, you're not comfortable with. You have angst, but you made the decision and you go with it anyway. It doesn't make you feel whole. So we do something to make peace. What a peacemaker is not is easygoing. One who does not care what anyone else does as long as that doesn't affect them. That's the attitude of many people today. As long as it's not bothering me, I won't bother you. We'll just keep peace amongst one another. That's not what Jesus is talking about. That's passive. There are things in this world that we need to advocate for and have conviction about. But in the midst of that, we're supposed to be peacemakers. We live in a world today where nobody wants to find middle ground. It sounds like compromise. We live in a world that likes conflict. We live in a world of cynicism. We live in a world that wants to generate controversy so that we can get more views or more reactions to what we post or tweet or say. Being a peacemaker doesn't mean you're always tolerant. We should care. Doesn't mean we tolerate. Now, intolerance in our world today has such a different meaning. In our world today, acceptance means tolerance. See, folks, as a peacemaker, we ought to be able to tolerate a lot. I don't have to accept anything. And you young people here, you're being grilled with this, and I hate doing this, but I'm going to tell you, your teachers are telling you that acceptance is tolerance. It's not. You need to accept them if you're going to, and if you don't accept them, then you hate them. There's no middle ground. There's no peace when there's no middle ground. And what's happening in the church is that we're saying the same thing. And we're settling for the same thing. I deal with this in our denomination all the time. If you don't think like I do, if you don't believe exactly like I do down to the T, then you're a heretic. You don't love Jesus. You don't know Jesus. And I have to be a peacemaker. It's hard. We're not always tolerant. We're not appeasers. There's no peace at any price. If you have to compromise your convictions to have peace, that's not peace. You know what appeasement is? It's avoiding conflict. All you're doing when you appease the situation is moving the conflict further down the road. That's all you're doing. How about that family reunion you got coming up? Amen. Y'all got family members that there's certain things you do talk about and certain things you don't talk about. Amen. Why? To keep the peace. Right? There are things we shouldn't tolerate in our own lives, much less from anybody else. And so we need to talk about that a little bit, and we'll talk about that more as we talk about the characteristics of a peacemaker. The first thing is you're honest. Honest. Everybody in here saying, I'm an honest person? Really? What I mean by honesty is this: if there's a problem, you admit it. You admit it. Now, you don't sit there and blast it. It doesn't mean you have the license to kill. But if there's a problem, you admit it. Jeremiah 6:14, they have treated my people's brokenness superficially, claiming peace, peace, when there is no peace. You ever had situations in life where it's like that thing that festers in the background that nobody wants to talk about, yet it causes tension in the room for the whole time it's there. And until it's addressed and dealt with, everybody is fake. Because we don't want to be controversial. We're supposed to speak the truth in love. That's what Paul says. Speak the truth in love. We're good at speaking the truth. We're just not good at the love part, are we? And that's the world we live in now. I'm speaking the truth. Whose truth? Whose truth? When it comes to situations in life, and I've done enough counseling of people in my time in ministry to know that there's one person's side of the story, there's another person's side of the story, and somewhere in the middle of that is the truth. But don't tell them that. Don't tell them that. Honesty's not a bad thing. We shouldn't treat it that way. Jesus does not want us to lie. He's not telling them to lie. Be honest. How many times in ministry have I heard somebody come to me, Pastor, I have a problem with this? Okay. Now, when you do that, what you guys have learned from me all too well is that I'll just come back and see you and say, well, I have a problem with you. It's not a tit for tat, but if we're going to be honest, let's be honest. People take that as confrontational. But I believe being a peacemaker is being proactive. That's what a peacemaker does. And you have to be, the second part of this, you have to be willing to risk pain in all of this. If you're going to be honest, you got to deal with the consequences. Jesus had to deal with the consequences of being honest with people. Amen. If you're going to be honest with people, you've got to be willing to deal with the consequences. The pain, it hurts sometimes. The peacemaker takes the risk of misunderstanding and failure when he tries to bring peace, whether personally or societally. A peacemaker's tendency is not to let things slide because it's not true peace. It often makes things worse. We're doing our 101 class today. We have 11 of them in there, and we're doing it English and Spanish, and we were talking before we came in here, and I'd use do the first hour talking about things about the church, and one of the things we talk about, and I'm just using this as an example, is worship. Right? Something that's supposed to bring unity to the body of Christ has caused more division in the last 40 years. And I'll remind you and what I told them, we don't argue about worship here. We don't. We already did it a long time ago. You don't like this? Come to 8:30. It's traditional. You want to worship in Spanish? Be here at noon. If it's too loud for you in here, come to 8:30. If it's too slow for you at 8:30, come to 10:15. If you don't know the songs they're singing at 8:30, they don't know the songs you're singing at 10:15. It ends up coming down to preference, not theology, because you guys have given up trying to battle me theologically on this issue because you lose every time. I'm just being honest. So we don't argue about it here, and we won't. We won't. I'm very proactive about it. You guys know me long enough in here to know that if I hear about it, I'm calling you. And it gets sniffed out quick. We're not that big. Pastor, what do you really hear about? Everything. So we got to deal with it. If you let things slide, it only makes things worse. It makes people gossip. It makes people go out underneath the street lights in the parking lot on Wednesday night. It makes people turn the prayer meeting into a gossip session in the name of prayer. I've been through all of it. I've sat through all of it.
We appreciate
that. The tendency is to delay it, and it just makes things worse. Not better. Ephesians 4:3, Paul says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Paul thought unity was important. Jesus thinks unity is important. Most of Paul's letters have sections in them dealing with unity within the local churches. Why? Because they deal with the same things we do. We're not the first church to have worship wars, neither is this century. Go to read book of 1 Corinthians and find out about the worship wars. Romans 14:19. So then let us pursue what promotes peace and what builds up one another. Y'all ought to highlight that. Too many people in the body of Christ, too many people in the church want to pursue stuff to create controversy. A peacemaker, my friends, is not a troublemaker. And some of you in this room, you spent your whole life being troublemakers. It's your badge of honor to be a troublemaker. You carry it around like you stick your chest out that you're a troublemaker. Guess what that says to Jesus? You got a problem. Peacemakers are not troublemakers. At least the peacemaker paradox. The peacemaker is a fighter. He or she wages war, not war, but peace. You're to wage peace. James 3:17 and 18. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peace-loving, gentle, compliant. We don't like that word in the high desert. High desert is filled with people who live in non-compliance. It's like the badge of honor around here. Nobody's telling me what to do. You know I'm right. I've seen it over and over again. Full of mercy and good fruits, unwavering, without pretense. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who cultivate peace. Makes you all want to put flowers in your head right now, doesn't it? Peace is supposed to be who we are as followers of Jesus. So what kind of peace do peacemakers make? Well, first of all, peace between people. We're to be conduits of peace between people. Hebrews 12:14 says, pursue peace with everyone and holiness. That means that you are completely set apart, separate. That's what holy means. And your life is to reflect an idea of holiness, but within that whole thing, you're supposed to pursue peace with everyone. Don't compromise your holiness, but pursue peace. Without it, no one will see the Lord. Folks, here's the deal. Sometimes in life, as a follower of Jesus, as you're in the world and not of the world, as you're like Jesus and hanging out with sinners, sometimes you got to know when it's time for you to just take your holiness and go home and walk out. Now, for me as a pastor, this happens all the time. Or people kind of change. Or I love this. When people cuss in front of me and say, sorry, pastor, I'm like, why are you sorry? But on the other side of that, if we're going to pursue peace and maintain our holiness, people ought to, when you walk in the room, know that you're a follower of Christ and know that it offends you when they take God's name in vain. Instead, we just say, I don't want to offend them. They just offended you. It's hard, isn't it? But we're to pursue peace. We're ambassadors for God to bring peace between God and man. Wow. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Many of you know this passage already. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Say, new creation. The old has passed away, and see, the new has come. Everything is from God, who has reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us, say us. Who's us?
Us.
You and me. You and me. The ministry of reconciliation. Well, what is that? That is, glad you asked, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and he has committed the message of reconciliation to us. Say us.
Us.
That message Jesus gave to you. You're a steward. You're a manager of it. That's what a steward is. You're a steward, you're an ambassador. What do ambassadors say? Not their own words. An ambassador speaks for the people they represent. Well, I don't know what to say for Jesus. Yes, you do. It's called the gospel. How are you to say it? In love. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. Since God is making his appeal through us. And let's just be honest here. We hear that and we're like, God, that was just not the smartest decision you ever made, is it? But he did. Once he made the decision, he made the decision. He doesn't change his mind. We plead on Christ's behalf. What do we plead? Be reconciled to God. When's the last time you said that to somebody? When's the last time I said that to somebody? He made the one who did not know sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. We're to bring peace between people. We are ambassadors of the peace that God provides through his son Jesus. And we're to share that. Not speak our words, his words. How about Jesus' words? For God so loved the world in this way, he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Those aren't my words, those are Jesus' words. For God did not send his son into the world to judge the world, but that the world through him may be saved. Those aren't my words. Those are Jesus' words. Jesus' words are the power of God and the salvation. The Bible is the power of God and the salvation. We're ambassadors for that. We represent. When you're an ambassador, you represent the person, the organization. In this case, you represent Jesus 24/7, 365. Amen. That's an incredible responsibility. And God knows that. That's why he gave us the Holy Spirit. By yielding, surrendering to the Holy Spirit, you can be an ambassador of peace. Not only between people, but between God and man, because that's what God wants us to do. I love the promise here. Jesus' promise to the peacemakers is that they will be called sons and daughters of God. Why would he say that? They're called sons of God because it's true. He's looking at the disciples. You can imagine the disciples here and listening to this. They've just got to be going crazy at this point, just like, man. You are the sons of God. Really? And when that R there, I've talked about it, it's emphatic. That they shall be called. They are the sons of God. It is a present. It's a passive voice, too. It's something that God places on you. It's not something you earn yourself. It's not something you can do to yourself. You can't knight yourself an ambassador for Christ. You don't have the authority, strength, power, or ability to do that. God himself calls you an ambassador of Jesus. He places that authority, that empowerment by the Spirit, those words in your heart. 1 John 3:1, so what great love the Father has given us that we should be called the children of God, and we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it didn't know him. So what do sons of God do? We reveal the character of God. What's one of the characters of God? Peace. That's why we're peacemakers. We reveal the nature of God in how we live out life. If we want revival in the next generation, guys, I'm going to be honest with you. This is what you got to talk about. Looking like Jesus in a world that doesn't want you to look like Jesus. The church looking like the church when the world doesn't want you to do that. It's true for adults too. We can't be afraid of being holy. We can't be afraid of being ambassadors. We can't be afraid of being peacemakers with conviction. Instead of sitting here silent while the world does what it does. Jesus isn't calling us to do that. We reveal the dignity we have as heirs of the kingdom of God. See, if you're a son or daughter of God, you are an heir. You have an inheritance. Ephesians 1, verse 11, it says this, in him we also have received an inheritance because we were predestined according to the plan of the one who works out everything in agreement with the purpose of his will, so that we who had already put our hope in Christ might bring praise and glory in him. You also were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and when you believed. The Holy Spirit is the down payment of our inheritance until the redemption of the possession to the praise of his glory. It's all there for you. We can be at peace because we're at peace with God. See, Jesus is the ultimate peacemaker. And if our lives are to follow Christ and emulate Christ, if we want to be like Jesus, His is the life to follow, not mine. Not even Paul's, as wonderful as Paul is. Paul says, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Now, a lot of us don't even want that. We don't want that responsibility. Romans 5:1 says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Ephesians 2:14, Paul says, for he is our peace, who made both groups one and tore down the dividing wall of hostility. John 14:27, Jesus said this to the disciples, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives, meaning not that kind of peace. Don't let your heart be troubled or fearful. Only the peace of God can make you not troubled or fearful. See, we are called to be peacemakers, not peacekeepers. We are to combat evil, war, conflict, and strife with a peace that passes all understanding. That's a peace with God and peace with ourselves. See, you can't bring peace unless you have peace with God. This is one of those things. And as you look at the Beatitudes, because this is the last one that's in third person, that we'll go to, the persecuted kind of goes into something else that we'll get into next time we get together. These all build on each other. Jesus is so intentional. To get to being peacemakers, you got to understand all the other ones before that. It's a ladder working your way up to being a peacemaker. Being a peacemaker, recognizing that you are poor in spirit. You are unable to save yourselves, but the kingdom of heaven is yours. Blessed are those who mourn their sin, who take sin seriously in their life, because they will be comforted. We have been. Blessed are those who are humble. If you recognize you can't save yourself, if you recognize you're separated from God because of your sin, and you know that and you trust in Jesus, yet that makes you humble. It doesn't make you proud. And you'll inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness because you have the Spirit and you want to learn to do things God's way, in God's will, in God's plan. You do that and you will be filled. God's not trying to hide His will for your life from you. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Once you understand the mercy that God has shown you, how can you not be merciful to others? Blessed are the pure in heart. It takes a new heart to be pure. Jesus gives us a new heart. Because we have a new heart, we'll be able to see God. We'll be able to see Jesus face to face when that time comes. But we are also able to see God now, as He works in us and among us. That's God working right there. That's seeing God. Some of you, when you're walking here, is like, I stand back there on purpose watching some of y'all walk into church when you walk into church. Seeing a bunch of kids up here bouncing around, doing their thing, I can see y'all going, what? This ain't church. According to who? Amen. According to who? David walked around in his underwear before the Ark of the Covenant. That's not very holy. Yet he was a man after God's own heart. According to who? The Sadducees and Pharisees weren't interested in peace either. They were interested in power. Peacemakers aren't interested in power. Blessed are the peacemakers. See, if you're going to live all these things, then we get to verse 10, where it talks about persecuted. There is no way, there is no way, there is no way that you can live this way and not be persecuted in this world. Amen. None. Jesus knows that too. That's why we're going to talk about it. We combat war with peace. And you can't bring peace to this world, folks, unless you're at peace with God first. Amen. Romans 12, 18, I love what Paul says here. If possible, as far as it depends on you. Not me. Not your mom, not your dad, not your grandfather, not your boyfriend, your girlfriend, your best friend. As far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. See, folks, in the kingdom culture, God approves of the people and blesses those people who pursue peace. They are the sons and daughters of God. Amen. Pastor Tim, I'm just going to close out with prayer. Since y'all, we took that song, we put it in the front end, we'll close it on the back end. Amen? Amen? Let me pray. Father, thank you for this time in your word. Lord, may we, in a world that hungers and thirsts for conflict, controversy, and cynicism, not be that way. Let us not be troublemakers, but be peacemakers. Let us not be passive, but active. Being the ambassadors you've saved us to be, and as far as it depends on us, be at peace with everyone. For your glory and your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Hey, thanks for being with us this morning. We'll see you back here next week here at Living Hope Church. Have a great one, everybody.